Hi everyone, this is GKCS. In this video, we'll talk about Apache Spark. So this is a paper from 2010, and this is from Berkeley. Apache Spark is probably the world's most popular data analysis system. It's used by software engineers, data analysts, data scientists, machine learning engineers. You know, I have personally also used it while I was working in a data analysis system. And the reason for its popularity is because it is such a generic system. Before Apache Spark, there were many systems which are specialized in the tasks that they used to do for data analysis. One of the systems we have already looked at is Dremel, which is really popular for count queries or aggregation statistical queries. There was also a paper written by Google called MapReduce. It had changed the way in which you could use commodity hardware to come up with data analytics. MapReduce was very good at batch jobs. Then there were streaming methods. Then there was Google Pregel, which used to perform page rank algorithms for Google. At very large scale, when you're running a graph algorithm, you want to run it in batch. Some of the principles of MapReduce were put into Pregel. But all of these are all specialized for their own use case. What Spark does is take them all together and put it under a single umbrella. Internally, it lets you do graph algorithms using something called GraphX. It lets you run machine learning algorithms also using something called MLlib. You have a SQL library for aggregate queries, and it allows MapReduce. So everything packaged in one. The benefit of this is if you're a data engineer, now you don't have to learn four different technologies. Everything is covered by Apache Spark. You can write your programs in the programming language of Spark, which is basically Scala, and that program will execute in any one of these systems. So this is the major benefit. It is extremely general purpose when it comes to data analytics. The second thing about Spark is that it is extremely scalable, but it's also extremely performant. This is much faster than MapReduce. It's in some cases 1,000 times faster than MapReduce. We'll see why. And finally, it is pluggable with various technologies. So if you want to run Spark with Kubernetes, that's possible. If your nodes are going to be all managed by Kubernetes, that's possible. You can use Mesos, you can use any other cluster manager, and Spark will not care, right? Spark just needs a way to run a cluster. It doesn't know how the cluster is being run or what is the internal workings of the cluster. Now, the first thing we should look at when it comes to these three requirements is, why is it so performant? It gives you a 1000x speed up in some cases, and on average, it gives you a 40x speed up over MapReduce. So how's this happening? The basic idea is pretty simple. Let's say you have a MapReduce job. This is how a typical MapReduce job looks like. You have some data that is being pushed into this system. So maybe you're trying to do a select star for all employees from a department. So you have different employees sharded into C1, C2, C3. These are going to be mapping the employee object to just the name, so e.name. Okay, this is the first step. Now you might say that let me sort this data set. So you're going to sort parts of this data set, and then you're going to aggregate it all together. So this would be a reducer operation where you would have the sorted names of all employees in a department. MapReduce is not very efficient when it comes to these kind of operations. The main reason for this is because the assumption at that time was this is going to be cheap commodity hardware. It can crash at any point in time. We can restart the entire process. This would be a very slow process. So you had the choice of either having a no fault tolerance, very slow process, which is restarting a lot of times, versus you actually storing intermediate results in between and using those results during failure. That takes a lot of disk space. Spark looks at this problem and says, what if I just store these results in memory? It's that simple. Instead of storing things in persistent storage, why don't I move it into memory? Now, if this mapper job fails, I can go and query the memory here, the output over here, and resend it to a new mapper, which I'll spin up. This will be much, much faster. Instead of pulling it from persistent storage, instead of using disk space, I'm going to be using memory, which may look more expensive, but it's so much faster. not only does it make the failure recovery faster, it makes the overall computation faster. So you no longer need to have intermediate results after every map job. You can put them all together in a single computer, run those functions together. It's no longer a full process of convert E to E dot name. You know, this would be a slow step in the MapReduce job. Now you can convert E to E dot name right here in the first computer itself. As long as you can perform that operation in memory, do it in memory and go to the next step. You see that the number of steps have been effectively reduced. Of course, you're performing the same number of operations, but each operation earlier used to have one stage. Now it has everything put together and everything is performed in memory. That gives you a huge speed up. It gives you a 40x speed up on average, but for iterative algorithms like PageRank, like some machine learning algorithms where there's backpropagation, this is just a lot more fast. It goes all the way to 1,000 times fast. In case there is not enough memory to pull in the data into a single computer, then Apache Spark will overflow it into disk. So its worst case behavior is MapReduce, and its best case behavior is like running it in local memory. Okay, it's much, much faster. Recent versions of Apache Spark actually are cache-aware, using cache-aware algorithms. So those think about the L1 cache, the L2 cache, the L3 cache. Before that, things were just kept in main memory. With the improvements of cache-aware algorithms, it's become even faster. Now imagine you are the professor at Berkeley. This is 2010. You don't have much money, but you have quite a bit of influence and respect. So you come up with this project and you say that I'm trying to solve the current problem of having four different systems for four different use cases by creating Apache Spark. How do I make it general purpose? And how do I make it pluggable with various existing technologies so that it becomes popular quickly? People don't have to migrate with difficulty. So one of the things you want to do then is to make sure that the Spark system is small. It should only focus on one thing, and that is computation. If you treat Apache Spark as a pure computation platform, the cluster management can be pluggable, the data sources can be pluggable, the network can be pluggable, everything can be pluggable except for computation. So as long as you give me some compute power and memory, I can run Apache Spark and I can give you results over data. And the best way to define this would be a program, a series of instructions which have to be executed. The benefit of this is you could write a script in Scala. You could say dot map. And what would happen is this arrow would basically be just this single line of code. The benefit of this is, like we said, if there is any fault in one of the computers, then you can look at the log of operations that it has gone through, the partitions that it has consumed when mapping and reducing, and then recreate this state using this log of operations. These are called RDD, which is resilient distributed data sets. Whenever there's a computation to be performed on these, let's say data.reduce, Spark first tries to see if this data exists in any of the cluster computer's memory. If it is, then assign that computer the operation because that's going to do it the fastest. If not, then try to find one of the preferred locations based on data locality. So for example, when you're sorting a data set, maybe you want to put the objects which are close to each other in the same partition. That would be data locality. The final point to note is who is managing this cluster. We mentioned Kubernetes or Mesos. Yes, either one of those can be used. Mesos is an extremely simple cluster manager. All it has is a leader and a bunch of followers. So when it has a set of computers which are performing operations, if Mesos says that I have enough compute capacity right now, I don't need to spin up a new instance, then a job which comes to Apache Spark is going to be assigned to one of the computers. If there isn't enough compute capacity, then it's going to spin up a new instance. So the leader Mesos instance spins up new follower instances, makes them perform computations, and when they're done, it releases those instances. So the entire cluster management is managed by Mesos. It is very similar to Kubernetes, but it's a bit more generic. And that's it. At a high level, Apache Spark is an aggregation of multiple specialized libraries. It runs over a cluster managed by Mesos. And the best thing about it is that it keeps things in memory. The strategy is to keep your intermediate results in memory for faster queries and fault recovery. If you have any doubts or suggestions on Apache Spark, you can let me know in the comments below. If you want to see more videos on system design, Interview Ready is the place. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye. Also, some interesting news. The system design course at Interview Ready with over 300 video lessons has been split into two. System Design Simplified, which covers high-level design, including the fundamentals, example interview questions, and research papers. And a low-level system design course, which covers solid principles, design patterns, and machine coding. Our hope is that this will help you complete the courses better and faster. So if you're focused on learning high-level design, System Design Simplified is what you can go for. If you're looking for low-level design, that's now a separate course. If you already purchased a system design course, this split is not going to affect you. You will have lifetime access to both courses. Thank you so much for your support. Both the courses are complete in themselves. You don't have to finish one to go to the next one. There is no prerequisite, no ordering. You can work on both in parallel also. Thank you so much for listening. I'll see you next time. Cheers.